So last but not least, we're going to get you up and moving yet again. My friend and colleague, Dr. Nusha Askari, is our final speaker. She has extensive clinical research, teaching, and administrative experience in neuropsychology and neuropsychiatry with a special focus on dementia. Her doctoral work in cognitive psychology gravitated her toward postdoctoral studies in neuropsychology, geropsychiatry, and neuroscience at Stanford. After about 20 years in academia as professor and chair in clinical psychology and gerontology at Notre Dame de Namur University, Nusha returned to Stanford to pursue her passion of helping older adults age more healthily. Her interest in ethno-geriatrics, diversity, healthcare advocacy, gravitated her toward her current position at the Stanford Alzheimer's Disease Research Center. Anusha and I actually worked together for several years at the Stanford ADRC to facilitate caregiver psychoeducational skill programs and develop and implement and evaluate an equine guided support program that is no longer at Stanford but is continuing at UC Davis in Sacramento. So Anusha is a certified Tai Chi, QiGong, and yoga instructor. All of the above, right? With over 10 years practice and training in all three. And she's volunteered her time in places such as the Stanford Neuroscience Center, Rosner House, Sunnyvale Community Center, and at independent living facilities. She is going to help you bridge East and West, as our other speakers in this set have done. And the title of her presentation is Moving to a Different Beat with Tai Chi and QiGong.
It is a pleasure to be with you all today. Dolores, thank you for the kind introduction. Pauline and conference committee members, thank you for inviting me. I'm delighted to be sharing with you the movements of Tai Chi and QiGong and how they can be integrated into the daily practices. So let me just give you an overview. I'm going to briefly touch on how Tai Chi and QiGong are relevant to dementia. I am blessed to be able to do these practices with people with neurological disorders, with neurodegenerative disorders, without dementia, with dementia, throughout different ages and stages of life, and so it's been an amazing journey, and I just am going to give you a little glimpse into this with the short time that we have together today. Talk to you very briefly about what is Tai Chi, that's more prominently known these days, the benefits, but then QiGong is less well known, and it's actually the predecessor to Tai Chi, and talk to you about the benefits of QiGong, how you can integrate these practices into your daily routine. And truly, as I said before, the caregivers, the family members, the people with dementia, anyone can benefit from these practices. It's never too soon or too late or too early or in the middle stages of life. You can do it at any point in time. That's the beauty of these practices. They can be used in all walks of life. So people with dementia typically experience a lot of agitation and anxiety, basically because of the processing difficulties that they're faced with, because things kind of get turned upside down for them, their whole world changes. As you've heard throughout the day, people with dementia will experience difficulties because they start losing a sense of self. And so by giving people skills where they can kind of center themselves, become more grounded, and just do things for and just become more aware of who they are physically as well as mentally and emotionally really helps them. These practices of Tai Chi and QiGong, and I'll specifically address one fall prevention program called Tai Chi Chuan, Moving for Better Balance, which is a fall prevention program that's been used with people with movement disorders, with dementia, and it's evidence-based, so I'll mention that one as well. But it's a good fall prevention treatment program that's been come about because people have controlled, deliberate, synchronized movements, and they integrate these with the breath, with the posture. All of these working together benefit both the caregiver and the person with dementia. So Tai Chi's origins are truly actually a mystery in China. They did originate in China, but there's a lot of secrecy because these are practices and lineages and schools of thought that are have been kept very secretive over time. Not much information has been let out, but the roots are in martial arts for Tai Chi. If you come from a Shaolin monastery, it'll be a more rigid Tai Chi style. If you're from the Wudong Mountain Monastery, it's a more fluid style of Tai Chi. Ultimately, Tai Chi Chuan is the most prominently known one. It does mean supreme ultimate fist, the Chuan meaning the fist, and supreme ultimate being the Tai Chi. The Tai Chi symbol that you see there is probably nowadays become very symbolic of this whole notion of yin and yang, the balance that we strive to strike in our daily existence. And actually, from a cultural, philosophical perspective, the universe coming from a state of nothingness, emptiness, chaos, and then having polarities of yin and yang, and always striving to achieve balance between soft, hard, dark, light, male, female, right, left. So doing things on all these different polarities. So there's an interplay of movement and stillness. There's a fullness and emptiness. Around 1956, post-communist revolution, Chinese government, so both Tai Chi and Qigong have had both spiritual as well as medical backgrounds. And so the government, in a way to try and kind of bring the populace together, in a way to kind of have a more controlled health practice, where they were very worried about if the spiritual and more medical Qigong got out, they didn't want these people to kind of defray the power. They wanted to contain the power. This was, I'm just giving you a quick run through of history here. They've created this 24 posture Tai Chi form that has become very prevalent as a healthy practice for people of all walks of life. And the beauty of it is that it creates overall well-being. It does integrate mindfulness. It is used for leisure, for physical fitness. It helps ameliorate physical symptoms of disease as well. So before I talk about the Tai Chi Chuan moving for better balance, I do want to talk about some of the basic tenets, and you will see a continuous theme here across the afternoon session. Breath is key. It modulates your flow. It's synchronized with your movement. Breath, yes, there is neuroregulation, there's physical regulation, your central nervous system, your peripheral nervous system, everything, your immune system, your circadian rhythm, all of those between the breath, the movement, the posture, become better regulated. So posture would be the other one. So rooted feet, weight primarily in the heels, 70% heel more, less in the balls of the foot. People who tend to fall, we tend to fall forward, right? But if you root your feet and you drop a little bit, you're less likely to fall forward, right? So you learn to, I'm going to take a leap through the stage now. But then the other one is also how we distribute the weight. So 70% weight in the right leg, 30% in the left leg. So 70-30 is a stance that you will typically see in the Tai Chi. So all of these in terms of how we shift our weight, how we move, how slowly we move versus how fast we move will have different types of effects on our physiology, on our brain, on our mind, on our emotional state. And you need to kind of be going through this yin and yang, striving to achieve balance and harmony. It's not always slow, it's not always fast, and it's not always right, it's not always left. You have to continually be striving. And I think a Taoist perspective, which is what I follow as well, is always be ready for chaos. Because as long as you're always in a state of readiness for change and chaos, you'll be just fine. You'll achieve balance and harmony. So wrap your minds around that one. But then with dementia, what do we have? What do we have with dementia? Yeah. So there we go. So this is why I love this program, because I think it's a great way to kind of work with what we have to work with. But the intention, the mindfulness, do play a role here, getting one to become better aware of one's breath. But then working in color, working in intention, working in emotion. Not running away from the negative emotions all the time, but you experience a negative emotion, fine. Acknowledge it, breathe through it, and let it pass. Going back to something that was talked about earlier today as well, in terms of with stress, not running away from it, Dr. Croswell, but actually kind of being in the moment. So there are methodical movements. They help you in turn to map these somatic the movements. These then in turn result in very tranquil, relaxed states of being. And the nice thing about Qigong, especially, Tai Chi is very is sequential movements. The movements have to be done in a certain sequence. You can't mix them up. There are specific forms. There are specific styles. There are specific schools of approach. And so, unfortunately, we don't have time to go through all of them. But Qigong, on the other hand, especially can be tailored for people with different forms of impairment, recovery from different types of diseases, and help in turn with fall prevention. But before I get into Qigong, I want to touch on the Tai Chi Chuan Moving for Better Balance. It was introduced by Dr. Fu Zhongli of the Oregon Research Institute. He is originally from China. His background is in sports medicine. I'm also certified to teach this program. I found out I'm the only person in California right now, but hopefully we're going to get more people trained to get this going. It's a 24-week program, 6 months, and two times a week, one-hour sessions. It is based on the eight-form Tai Chi Chuan movements. They've taken it, they've used it with people with Parkinson's disease, which is a movement disorder. I have also done this with people with Parkinson's, at least parts of it, many therapeutic movement parts, and it does help them. But they compared people to a control group, and they found that there was better movement control, sensory integration, stride length, ability to reach forward. And a distinction I'll make for you between what Tai Chi Chuan, Moving for Better Balance, does versus Tai Chi is, this might be, I'm just going to give you a little glimpse, this might be, quote, regular Tai Chi. Actually, I need to step back so that I don't fall off the stage here. So, and then, okay, Tai Chi Chuan will take this last part that I did, which is grasp sparrow's tail. And what you do is you wind up. So notice I'm on this leg. This one's unsteady. You wind up, become unsteady. Drop, become steady. Sorry. Drop, become steady. Okay? And then you go. You might actually part the horse's mane. And then, whoop! That's the difference. Notice, I didn't do the whoop before, did I? But with the Tai Chi Chuan Moving for Better Balance, it's whoop. You think she's going to fly off that stage any minute? Oh, no. But so, and then you'll do the same thing on the other side. You come back. You wind up. Settle. Part the horse's mane. Whoop. And there we go. And that's just a small portion of it. Okay. So, some little, don't worry, I'm going to get you all up in a little bit. We're going to have fun together. So, they did some other studies. They looked at cognitive function. Indeed, they found on the mini mental state exam, they had better cognitive scores. There was improved physical balance. People had fewer falls, fewer visits to the emergency room. 6 months later, they actually compared in the Harmer and Fitzgerald study, they actually took a multimodal exercise program that was flexibility aerobics and strength training, compared it to Tai Chi Chuan Moving for Better Balance, and then stretching with people that were prone to falls. And indeed, they found that both the multimodal and the Tai Chi Chuan groups had fewer falls than the stretching. 6 months later, post these programs having ended, they followed these people, had them log whether they continued to do exercise, and indeed they found that the people who had participated in the Tai Chi Chuan, TJQ MBB, for lack of trying to keep saying that all the time, they had the lowest number of falls and emergency room visits, followed by the multimodal exercises, and lastly, the stretching. And I was asked, to talk about cost of these programs compared to some of the other programs. Dr. Lee and his colleagues also looked at cost analysis, and indeed, TJQ-MBB had lower cost in terms of overall cost, be it for training, classes, et cetera, than the resistance or stretching programs. So QiGong. QiGong, the Q is a ch sound. Qi means life force energy. And gong is the craft or skill of that. So basically, I interpret QiGong as the cultivation of life force energy. From a Western perspective, because of my neurophysiology background, I always tie this in for my participants. I say, you know what? You have all these neural impulses, all these electrical impulses. We're all fired up with all this electrical synapses, neurophysiological synapses, and we always wonder what it is. Qi is that. That is qi. That's your, it's what you naturally emanate is that energy. And we heard other people, I think Dr. Croswell made an allusion to this earlier in terms of that we pick up energy from other people. It's true, you do. and you respond to it and you react to it. And there's a lot of Eastern research on this, but it's starting to kind of flow into the Western hemisphere as well. So QiGong is over 2,000 years old. It actually started with probably the Dao Yin exercises. In a moment, I'll show you the Dao Yin II scrolls from 160 BCE that was found in the tomb of King Ma. Whereas again, the Tai Chi is the sequential movements, QiGong postures can be standalone. You are always striving to achieve that balance and harmony, but you are integrating different movements and the breath to do that. So in turn then, you achieve mental, emotional, physical, and spiritual well-being. These are the Dao Yin II scrolls that were found in the tomb of King Ma, who was an emperor. And if you look, I don't have a pointer, but the second one from the top on the left side, separate heaven and earth, we're going to do that together. So I just wanted to kind of give you a little glimpse. We will shortly. Yeah, I'm getting there, Dolores. I don't know where I am on time, but I'm getting there. I'm going close, as fast as I can. So when you work with Dolores, you learn to talk fast. I'm going as fast as I can. So again, the QiGong was designed as a health exercise, designed actually as a medical QiGong. Medical QiGong is actually a practice in and of itself. And so QiGong can be used for healthfulness, for spirituality, and from a medical perspective. You can modify the exercises with QiGong as you can with Tai Chi. Tai Chi is primarily standing and walking exercise. QiGong can be done standing, can be done walking, can be done lying down, can be done sitting down, can be done in all sorts of different ways. And the movements, in turn, can be modified. So you don't need any equipment whatsoever. You can show up in your nice, comfortable clothes, practice in shoes, without shoes. Ideally, outside in nature is the best way to go. Do them in groups, do them individually. There is a benefit to doing both. And I will tell you why. Like I mentioned before, we pick up energy from other people. You've heard about sangha, being in the sangha with one another, being in a yoga, being in a yoga class, being in a choir. We feed off of each other's energy levels when we do these different types of transformative exercises, transformative practices that in turn can impact us in a very powerful way. So ultimately, it's 2,500 years old, the benefits. It is simple, but not so simple that it cannot be profound. And I'll just tell you very quickly, I had the opportunity to work with an individual who had both cognitive impairment and Parkinson's disease. And so in Parkinson's disease, oftentimes you will see a very stoic, stony-like face. This person was from Malaysia, did not speak any English whatsoever, came with some family members. She participated in my class the first day. She couldn't understand anything I was doing. I would just kind of smile at her, have her do the, by the end of the class, 1 hour, big smile lit up her face. It was such a gift. It was such an honor to have been a part of that. So this gives people a sense of control over their life, however chaotic it might be, however uncertain it might be. This is something that when they do it, they feel good about it. And it can, again, you don't necessarily have to understand everything. You don't have to necessarily even do everything the same way, but just as long as you engage in the practice. So the Qigong, the Tai Chi, the mindfulness, the yoga, all of these help people gain a sense of enhancement, of transformation in their mental, physical, emotional, and spiritual well-being. And so it's a whole person transformation. Is it going to happen overnight? I'll tell you, sometimes it's a really fast effect, but typically it's got to be a long-term effect, which is why you want to practice on a regular basis. I personally don't see any drawbacks. I think the benefits far outweigh any drawbacks. I found less research, evidence-based research from a Western perspective on the Tai Chi and the Qigong, but I did find some where they combined them into a traditional Chinese exercise, looking at literature reviews, meta-analyses, where they combined different studies together and put all the data together. Indeed, they did find better visual spatial function with people who have mild cognitive impairments / MCI. They've looked at anxiety, depression, blood pressure, the stress hormones of cortisol, adrenocorticotropic hormone, ACH, all of these have been reduced. So your parasympathetic system is what's being triggered here a lot with all of these practices. And you've heard about parasympathetic. So sympathetic is fight or flight. Parasympathetic is breath. It's balance. It's harmony. And yeah, I can switch gears very quickly on both of those, so it's nice. You get enhanced quality of life, you get improved sleep, you get reduced stress levels, so all of these are benefits. And they've also looked at people with dementia as well as people with mild cognitive impairment, comparing Western cardio exercises to the traditional Chinese exercises of Tai Chi and Qigong, and find there's much more stable dementia rating scales and improved visual span, because you have to become more visually aware as you do these exercises. So I was asked to touch very quickly on some logistics for you in terms of what goes into these practices. Disclaimer, always please check with your physician before you engage in any form of exercise. I need to let you know that. Not all people know about what Qigong is. They can always Google it. Nowadays, just go to Google and you can read more about it. In terms of logistics, you know, there are lots of programs around the Bay Area. I could not even bring myself to try and gather information for you, because ultimately, in my opinion, it's a personal choice. Just like you pick a physician that you feel comfortable with, you need to find a practitioner, an instructor that you feel comfortable with. Ideally, just like you would want to go to somebody who had the proper education in medicine, you would want to go to somebody who's certified, who's had training, who has taught for several years, and especially in the aging field, someone who has worked with older adults, someone who has worked with people with dementia, someone who understands what that entails is a critical piece of it. So try to do it 2 or 3 times a week, 1 hour per day. You know, instead of a cup of tea every morning, I get up after I do my ablutions, I get up and I practice. So that's my cup of tea every morning. It's just part of my daily routine, and I feel very fortunate to be able to continue to do that. Cost can vary. You go to a large class, it might be as little as $25 a person. You go to a class of maybe 6 to 8, possibly 95. If you go to a class of maybe two or three. It could be as much as $150, depending on the person's training. But again, it really varies. I mean, the more people there are, the probably the lower the cost. Ultimately, the costs that you put out in terms of these classes versus going to the hospital will always be lower. So I have in your handouts, I think I can stand here and tell you all the wonderful things about it, but ultimately, if you see what other people have said who've done this, these are some of the people who've been in my QiGong class at the Neuroscience Center and what they've had to say, and I'll let you read about those testimonials in the handouts. Basically, to summarize, they're effective techniques that yield powerful effects. You can tailor them to meet diverse needs. It can be done sitting, it can be done standing, it can be done with a little bit more direction with somebody who needs the direction, such as someone with dementia. They are cost effective, they can be done individually or in groups. The nice thing about these practices is caregivers benefit just as much. That first testimonial was from a caregiver. They can benefit just as much, if not more, than the person with dementia. But ideally, you bring both people together in that setting, and both people can benefit together, not only from what the effects are, but also in I have a couple. It is so beautiful to watch how they're always so warm and loving towards one another as they practice the QiGong with each other. So it's safe, it can improve your health and your stability, and it can lower your healthcare costs. And quite frankly, it's simple, accessible, and fun. So how can you learn more about some of these programs? The Neuroscience Supportive Care Services is the first link. They have classes like Dance for Parkinson's, Reiki, Chair Yoga, Tai Chi. I teach a QiGong for Vitality class 3:30 on Thursdays. It's free to all people who have neurological disorders and their caregivers. So it is a community on a community-wide level, so it's free. My email is there should you need to contact me. And because the Stanford Alzheimer's Disease Research Center does, guess who got them to do this, but it does sponsor the QiGong class. I did want to put there for you the information on the ADRC. We are a research center that is looking at mild cognitive impairment, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, Lewy body disease, and healthy individuals across a longitudinal period of time, over a period of time. So one last thing, these are the references, the numbers coincide to what you had on the handout. I would like to have you all stand up, and here is where we're going to do some QiGong together. And here are some rules of thumb. First of all, don't just run away when we're done. I would ask that the first thing that you do, and I'll give you the cue, the first thing, don't say anything, nothing. Just write down on the back of your handout in a few words or a sentence your experience. It could be sensory, it could be an impression, it could be a thought, whatever it is. Just when you're immediately finished, after I give you the cue, please go ahead and write a few words. We'll go ahead and do that. So we will move to a different beat, and here's another rule of thumb. I would like you to reach this way, make sure you're not gonna hit anybody in the face or anything, then turn around to the side and make sure you're not gonna hit anything. So if you need to space yourself out, there's plenty of space here, there's plenty of space there, feel free to, or go further back, whatever you want, so spread out and give yourself some space, okay? How much time do I have? Okay, good, yeah. So here's how we will begin. Have your feet parallel, distance apart, Bella. Let me try that one again. So as wide as your hips, yes. So straight forward, okay? And then take a moment, fold your hands, and we will do this at the end as well. So take the two thumbs next to each other like this. Fold the first thumb, it doesn't matter which one. Fold the other one on top. Take these hands and put them on your belly about 2 inches below your navel. Okay? Take a deep breath in through the nostrils. Exhale through gently flared lips. through the nostrils. Exhale through gently flared lips. On this last one, see if you can close your eyes. Center, focus inwards. Inhale through the nostrils. Exhale through gently flared lips. Very nice. Can you still see me? That's what comes with being so small. There we go. Inhale upwards, reaching up to the sky. Grab a white cloud from the sky. Bring it down as you slowly exhale to wash away all your cares from in front of you. Inhale, gently bending at the knees. Continue to inhale upwards. Grab another cloud. Pull it down gently to wash behind you as you exhale. One more time, inhaling up from the earth, reaching up to the heavens, pulling a cloud, letting the crown of your head open up as if this cloud is going to cleanse you through and through in your inner core. Let it gently glide down through your inner core, washing all of your organs of any ills, any cares, any concerns. Very nice. Now you can have one hand here to the side of the leg or one hand here on the belly again. You inhale, scooping cobalt blue water up. As you reach up to the heavens, turn the palm to go backwards. Exhale down, bending the elbow, bending the knees. Still looking straight forward, inhaling up, turn, exhale down. Try to extend the arm all the way up. Then as you turn, bend down here and allow it to go the full cycle. As we get here to the side, we will reverse, inhaling back and up. Here's the polarity. Inhale, drop the shoulder, drop the elbow, drop the wrist. Inhale up.